So as I was saying, we want to examine these issues and how we can walk together carefully so that we might accomplish the glory of the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen?
Amen.
That's the whole point. The whole point of our lives is to glorify Jesus with our lives. And now that we've been sanctified, we've been made holy, as Brother David was talking about, and we go out and seek men. Jesus Christ said, I'll make you fishers of men. Mm-hmm. Do you fish for men? If you're not fishing for men, what's your faith about?
Exactly.
What's the whole point Jesus Christ left us here for?
Exactly.
It's to fish for men.
Amen.
It's to pray and preach and seek God's will and work for our lives. Amen?
Amen.
So this walk is a narrow and difficult way. It's not easy. We all know many people, many stories of, man, that guy was a good preacher. What happened to him? Oh, this, and that, and this.
Yeah.
Where is he? And another preacher up here in this conference said, well, I wonder where people be in 2 years.
Yeah.
I say to you, I wonder where people be in 2 months.
Yeah.
Or 2 weeks. Yes. You better watch yourselves.
Amen.
Yeah.
The Bible says, examine yourselves daily to see if you're in the faith.
Right.
If we're all seeking the faith by the Holy Ghost, won't we study? Won't we pray that the Holy Spirit would instruct us daily?
Amen.
But if you're not willing to learn, if you're not willing to be taught, how are you going to learn? If you're just the teacher that everybody comes to, everybody knows you know everything about the Bible, how is it possible you can learn? You become the master. All right. So there are some ways that we can do this. The first thing I already mentioned is examining yourself. That's a good way to make sure you're staying on the narrow, difficult way. You're not falling to the left, falling to the right.
Right.
You're pleasing the Lord with your attitudes and your speech and conversation, conduct. Brother David brought that up. All manner of conversation. Of course, the New King James Bible says, conduct.
Yeah.
I need that stick, James. Need that stick up here. Okay, so I have been in the last 5-6 months or so, I've been studying some issues and I've got a King James Bible up here now, so if I stumble across some verses, it's because I'm trying to shift gears back into that King James Version after having read the New King James now for about 8 years. I never did forsake the King James, just a little sidebar here. Never did forsake the King James. I still always thought it was a good translation. But I was reading the New King James because in my thinking, I said, well, you know, the carnal mind will hear these words better.
Amen.
And in a sense, they do. And you're out preaching, it sounds easier than these and thous and froward and all that stuff. But, man, there's some serious things here.
Yeah.
I'm going to bring up a couple things today. I'm not here to put down your translation or lift up another translation, but I'm going to tell you, there's a couple things I want to talk about today with this unity of Holy Spirit believers that goes, wow, why is that so different? Why is that so different? Do we recognize the differences the Lord has put amongst us? Maturity levels. All right, we talked about 1 Timothy 4. You know, recognize the older men. There's some old guys back there. One day, you young guys will be the older guys. We'll be gone in glory with the Lord Jesus. Hallelujah. And you young guys now, I don't despise your youth, by the way, because you're the ones that are going to take our place.
Yeah.
You're going to take our place. Pretty soon we're going. Amen.
Amen.
Hallelujah.
Hallelujah. No more.
There's going to be a departure from you. And we only expect this thing to grow. Amen, Reuben?
Amen.
We only expect that, you know, you see this thing grow? Grow.
Wow. Amen.
Praise the Lord.
Amen, brother.
And I haven't been here in a while. I'm glad to be back.
Amen. Amen.
Praise God.
Glad to have you,
brother. Amen.
We missed you.
Yeah.
I missed you guys, too. Mm. All right. Back to the checks and balances that we should employ. The Holy Ghost constrains us. Amen. One of the fruits of the Holy Spirit is self-control.
Yeah.
Self-control.
Amen.
That's a fruit of the Holy Spirit. Well, you don't have to be speaking all the time. That's one thing we talked a lot about today. You know, there's a preacher up there preaching. You don't have to be speaking while that preacher's preaching.
Right.
We're talking about open air now.
Right, right.
Interrupting the preacher. He's preaching God's word. You got to throw in your opinion. This thing's getting beat up.
Right? Yeah.
All right. Keep beating it.
Yeah.
Keep hammering it, brother.
Okay, I mean, it's...
Come on, let it happen, brother.
anyway, so you got this preacher up here, God's word's flowing out of him.
Yeah.
On campus or on the street, wherever. And you're over here making a bunch of racket preaching to one guy. You're rebuking one guy, and this guy's over here preaching to 50 people. You know what them 50 heads do? Yeah. They go over here.
Yes.
Hey, look at this guy over here. You're rebuking this one guy. Come on, man, use some sense.
Amen.
Use some sense. Pray for that preacher.
Amen.
You want to do a one-to-one off the side? No problem. Do it. All right. Holy Spirit is one of the fruits. Fruits mean for repentance. Daily self-examination. Now, I want to talk about Matthew 18 briefly. Turn your Bibles to Matthew chapter 18. All right. You ain't there yet. You better get there. Matthew 18. We'll start in verse 14. Amen. Even so, it is not the will of your Father, which is in heaven, that one of these little ones should perish. Now, with that in mind, we're going to talk about the next part here. Starting in verse 15. Moreover, if thy brother shall trespass against thee, go and tell him his fault between thee and him alone. Let's say it again. Go and tell thy brother thy trespass against thee, and tell him his fault between thee and him alone.
Yeah.
If he shall hear thee, thou hast gained thy brother.
Amen.
If he hears you, you've gained your brother. But if he will not hear you, then take with thee one or two more witnesses, that in the mouth of two or three witnesses every word may be established. So there's a second step there. First step is go to him alone. Second step is to bring a witness, one or two. Now let's talk about this step before we go further, because these witnesses that you're going to bring haven't heard a thing. Except, brother, I've got a problem.
Amen.
I got a Matthew 18 situation where you come in here and you go before that man that you went for before and you tell him his fault in front of that witness or two, and they haven't heard a thing from you yet. They don't have any predispositions to your situation.
Amen.
You go there and you explain to that man again, listen, brother, I think you're in sin. This is the problem. You need to repent. And this one or two witnesses, they hear it. And well, they see. They're going to judge it now. They're going to judge the response of the accused. See, because you've actually started a little hearing here. Mm-hmm. Even with the first step, you've started a little hearing. Because the hearing between you and the accused and the Holy Ghost, Father, Son, the Holy Ghost. Now, everybody's listening to this. If you got an accusation against a brother, you better make sure your accusation is pure and true. Mm-hmm. Okay?
Yeah.
Pure and true. Now, so we take the first step alone, second step, now we have one or two witnesses. They haven't been predisposed. They didn't get a bunch of information off the internet. They don't know anything about this situation except you have a need. You have a need for them to come and witness what's going on. So you make the accusation. And the brother responds, or doesn't. I don't blankly blank care. That's not a sin. I'm not going to hell. Leave me alone. Okay. Now, the word's been established. Or, the brother says, well, I don't think that's a sin, and you talk about it, and in the front of the whole point is to reconcile, right?
Mm-hmm.
The whole point is to clear the matter off the table, to be transparent with everybody. Maybe I said something to you, you didn't understand it, and you come back to me and say, well, brother, I think that's sin. Okay, fine, let's talk about it. That's the right way.
Yeah.
And then if we can't talk about it as Christians, we can't love one another and communicate enough to figure these things out and clear it off the table, then shame on us.
Right.
We know better than the heathen.
Yeah.
Now, the heathen seem to work out things better than us sometimes, huh?
Yeah.
Isn't that true?
Yeah.
Right.
All right. So back to the second step. So either the guy is not receiving the accusation, he's not guilty, and the one or two witnesses that you brought with you, they're watching this and they're going to make a decision. They're either with you or they're now against you. Okay? They're either with you or now they're with the accused. Or maybe it even splits. Maybe it splits the two that you brought. Each one judges it differently. 1 Corinthians 6:4 says to let the least esteemed among you judge.
It does.
Let the least esteemed, the youngest of you. Where's the youngest Christian in here? Give me somebody that's been born again less than a year. Born again less than 2 years? Okay, so there they are. Come on up here, guys. Come up here. Appreciate your help. Please. Now these men are the judges for those of you that think you're so high and mighty and think you know everything and you've been accused. Now these men are going to judge us. Okay, so I come bring the accusation, they hear it, they judge it, their brother John would think you're wrong. Why? They give me the scriptures. Oh man, I never saw that scripture before. Thank you. I don't despise your youth. I appreciate you. Amen. I repent.
Amen.
I repent of my accusation. Brother, will you forgive me? 7 times 7?
Amen.
No, 7 times 70.
Yeah.
7 times in a day. And see, if you're doing this thing right, in the military we call it handling it the lowest level possible. Okay, guys, that's good. Go ahead.
Amen.
Thank you. Good job. I appreciate that. Handle it. I spent 21 years in the Navy. Amen. Sacrifice, do or die.
Amen.
Uh-huh.
Amen.
So in the military, we say handle it the lowest level possible. You private, you got a problem, fix it. I know how to do it in the Marine Corps. I've watched it. It ain't pretty. So for Christians, we're supposed to handle the lowest level possible. Should we consider each other more important than ourselves? Are you more important than somebody else, really? You're a part of the body of Christ? Isn't every part important? I don't need my foot. I don't need my thumb. You ever tried to do something without your thumb?
Uh-huh.
Ever broke your thumb? You know what it's like to have an opposing thumb? It's necessary. Every part of the body is necessary. Now, like I was saying, boy, we have all these different doctrines, all these different thinkings, these machinations of the mind. And Jesus Christ said, love God with all your mind. Amen?
Amen.
Love God with your mind. Don't stop thinking about your faith because you have to engage your mind. God's holy word, Lord, wash me, please. Wash me with your word. Give me understanding, Lord. Help me understand what I need to do and say here. Okay, back to 7th step. So either the person that accused repents of their accusation because it's wrong, the judge has figured out, no, brother, that's wrong because of this, or the accused doesn't repent of what he's doing, and it is sin, the two judges figured out, well, brother, you need to repent. That's all there is to it. And if he doesn't repent, now he comes before the body. Now, how that works out, I don't know.
Yeah.
You know, I'm going to invite you to your own judgment. Come on up here and invite you to your own judgment. It's not likely you want to come.
Okay.
Especially if you're guilty.
Right.
You've already been approached in Matthew 18 manner, step 1, step 2, step 3. It's not likely that you're going to want to come to church that Sunday. Mm-hmm. Amen? It's not likely you're going to want to come. But if you don't come, the church is going to come to you. Door knocking ministry, amen?
Amen.
Door knocking ministry, step 3, here we go. That every word may be established before the ecclesia, the church. You didn't follow my directions. Who was it? Just confess it right now. There it is.
Repent!
Stop it! See how easy that is?
Yeah.
See how easy that is? Oh, brother, I'm sorry.
Good example.
Right. Hallelujah. Yeah, should we be merciful?
Yes.
Yeah, we should be full of mercy because the Lord has been merciful to us.
Mercy.
Yeah. We've been forgiven so much that anything that we wouldn't forget. I want to give you an example from last night. Brother James up here, he's preaching. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And he says, my family was offended. I go, Lord, is that me? And we talked about that at the beginning of this conference, right? Lord, is it me? Well, so maybe it is me. Maybe I did. I was only speaking for about 3 or 4 minutes at Georgia Tech. Just 3, but I said some things that could be pretty coarse and pretty crude. So I went back to him to clear the table, to be transparent before him, before the Lord, because I got to preach this morning.
Yeah.
I'm going to go home. I'm going to let the sun go down on his anger and his wrath. And man, why would I do that? You know, God, who's the most humble man in the universe?
Jesus Christ.
Jesus Christ.
Me.
Yeah,
really? He washed your feet? You wash his feet? Really? You're willing to wash his feet? Are you sure? Let's get them shoes off. Let's get it going. Let's get the foot washing party going.
Hey, we're foot washing Baptist over here.
you know that it's more, it's really humbling to wash somebody's foot, but it's actually really humbling to have your feet washed.
It is.
You know that?
Yeah.
It is.
It's really, let that man be down there and he's washing between your toes and all that jam and man.
Yeah.
Our Lord and Savior, the creator of the universe, hallelujah, the one who made you in your mommy's womb, he washed dirty feet of the disciples.
Amen.
What did Peter open his mouth? Did he say something stupid again?
Yeah.
He repented though, didn't he? He said, Lord, wash all of me.
Yeah.
Right? I got that right?
Yeah.
He said, Lord, wash all of me. We need to all be washed, amen. So, of course, we want to be holy. We want to live holy. And talk holy. Think holy. All right, so where are we? We covered step one, step two, step three, Matthew 18. At the end of Matthew 18, if the guy still will not repent of whatever sin it is he's brought amongst us, then he's got to go, right? I mean, you just can't have fellowship with that sin. Can't have fellowship with darkness. And Brother Jed told me, he says, you know, I've never seen Matthew 18 done right. I said, what? How is it the Christian church cannot do this instruction from the Lord? It's in there.
Yeah.
Yes,
it's in there.
Amen.
And how can we, as holiness Christians, whatever you're believing right now at this moment, how is we, holiness Christians, we can't do that? Mm-hmm. How come we can't figure it out?
Amen.
I think we can. Not because I'm teaching it, because the Lord taught it. Amen.
Yeah.
Hallelujah.
Amen.
All right. I need some water. My help needs to come here. Okay. Here,
bud.
There it is. I got it, Dick.
Thanks. Right.
All right, so the conclusion of Matthew 18 is the separation if he doesn't repent. Good reason for that. Who can tell me about the story of Achan, starting with the youngest? Somebody give me a little heads up about the story of Achan. You remember Achan, young man? Who's Achan? Who's Achan? Well, Achan was a soldier, was he not?
Yep.
He had a family too, did he not?
Right.
He had a family. I suppose they were living in holiness. He had a tent that his family lived in. Ended up that he and his family went out and got stoned. Not on marijuana. They got stoned because they did not obey the Lord. He did not obey the Lord. He brought some stuff, put it back underneath the tent. And that leaven is why when Joshua went to attack Ai, they got whooped. They got slaughtered, Ai, because of sin.
Yeah.
A little bit of sin in the camp.
In the camp.
So brother, if you think that I've sinned against you, you have a duty and obligation to come and talk to me. One to one. Let's straighten it out, man. I just want to be transparent with you. I want to be everything cleared above board with you. This is the Christian walk. Because you know one day there's going to be a day of transparency. Perfect transparency. It's called Judgment Day.
Yeah.
That judgment seat that Brother Dave was talking about. So the judgment seat, everything's going to be clear.
Yeah.
There's going to be no hiding. Oh, my ministry this, my ministry that. Oh, he wasn't doing this right. I didn't think I needed to talk. I could block him on Facebook. You know, Facebook just kills me. It just kills me. You know, I love this brother right here. I love these. I love all you guys. But Facebook, man, we can't see each other and hear each other's intonations and all the different things that we mean when we communicate with each other. It's got to be really face to face. If you haven't an issue with a brother, make it face to face, man.
Yeah.
Or at least a phone call. Forget that Facebook.
Yeah.
That thing is good. We can use it for good things, but man, it can be a devil's device.
Yes.
It can be, and I confess it, man. I confess. I ain't used it the right way sometimes.
Yeah.
I confess that. Good. If I've offended you. Okay. How should we treat those in the household of faith? Do we have perfect and completed understanding? Or the moment-by-moment perfection of seeking the truth? Did you catch that? Do I have complete understanding right now? Or is it the perfect understanding of seeking the truth moment by moment, by moment by moment, minute, hour, hour, day by day, month by month? Hey, brother, give me the truth. I want the truth. Give it to me. What do you got? Boy, those machine gun preachers. I love them machine gun preachers.
Yeah.
I love them, man. Man, that's good stuff, man. The word being poured into us.
Amen.
So, we should be seeking the truth, continuing to understand. I wanted to share a thought with a brother from North Carolina. He said that, you know, brother, these formal teaching sessions, I really get a lot out of them, but you know, I get the most out of interpersonal and small group and one-to-one interaction between other believers. And you know, as iron sharpens iron, we were talking about that this morning, right?
Yeah.
Iron sharpens iron, and there's some sparks going to fly, right?
Sure.
But that blade's going to get sharp.
Right.
But you've got to stand in the heat of it.
Yeah.
And then you got to temper that sword. You got to cool it with water. Yeah. You know, you build a sword, right? You do it that way. You sharpen it. You lay another layer of steel on there. You temper it. Back in the fire. Sharpen it. Temper it. That's how you're going to build a long, strong sword. You're not going to build it by running away from a hard argument.
Right.
If your position is true, then by golly, you can stand on it all day long. Here's God's word. I stand on it by faith. Amen.
Amen.
Right.
And I've changed so many positions the last 20 years, I don't even want to cover it all. I love the Lord by faith. I know He's the Alpha and the Omega. Amen. He's the Alpha.
Amen.
His blood has cleansed me, and I'm being saved. Amen.
God.
And I want to walk according to the Holy Spirit because He's worthy.
Amen.
As we walk by the Spirit, we should be walking together by the Holy Spirit. That narrow, difficult way leads to life.
Amen.
All right. Galatians chapter 6, verse 9 and 10. Let us not be weary in well-doing.
Yes.
For in due season we shall reap if we faint not.
Amen.
As we have therefore opportunity, let us do good unto all men, especially unto them that are the household
Amen.
Of faith.
Amen.
Especially unto each of you, that we patiently talk to each other, that we carefully talk to each other, that we listen twice as much as we speak to each other. And you know what? If we do that, then probably we'll be able to keep everything transparent and keep everything above board, and we'll be able to walk together despite our doctrinal differences and go out there and preach the gospel. Hallelujah.
Yeah, hallelujah.
The gospel's been covered many times here in this conference. And the gospel is not this doctrine or that doctrine. The gospel is Jesus. Jesus
Amen.
Is the word of God. Hallelujah.
Amen.
Jesus died for sin and sinners. Sinners need to turn from it.
Amen.
The good news is they can be saved from their sin.
Amen.
Saved from damnation for His glory. For the fearing of God. You know, you fear God and keep His commandments, for this commands all.
Amen.
God will bring every work into judgment, including every secret thing.
Yeah.
You got secrets, Christians? You got secrets? You better open it up.
Yeah.
You better open it up. That little bit of leaven in there is going to twist your heart, and pretty soon you'll be one of the dead soldiers, man. You'll be off on the side of the narrow way.
Yeah.
All right. 1 Timothy 4:16, already mentioned one time. Thank you, brother. Take heed unto thyself, unto the doctrine, continue in them. For in doing this thou shalt save thyself and them that hear thee. You know what a trembling thing it is to come up here and teach you?
Yes.
Right. Teachers have a stricter judgment.
They
I
do.
Tremble at the thought right. of teaching anyone, sinners included, but especially the household of faith.
Yeah.
Because God's going to give me an account for what I've said up here.
Yeah.
Every word,
oh, God.
Every motive, everything, I'm going to give an account to us.
Right.
Hell yes.
Ephesians 4:14, that we henceforth be no more children, tossed to and fro, carried about every wind of doctrine by the sleight of men and cunning craftiness, whereby they lie in wait to deceive. Isn't right doctrine going to lead us to a right gospel?
Yeah.
Isn't that true?
Wow.
Right doctrine can lead us to the right gospel. That's all there is to it.
Yeah.
So let us be humble with each other, humbly walk together, and we'll get there. Hallelujah.
Amen, brother.
And I'm seeking the truth, you're seeking the truth, we're being transparent with each other, we're not considering each other better than the other.
Right.
All right. Now, real quick, because I don't have much time left, I want to talk about Romans 14. Turn to Romans 14, please. Romans 14, starting in verse 1. Romans 14, starting in verse 1. Him that is weak in the faith, receive ye.
Mm-hmm. Amen.
But not the doubtful disputations. For one believeth that he may do all things, another who is weak eateth herbs. Let not him that eateth despise him that eateth not. For God's received him. How? By the blood. Mm-hmm. By Christ. By faith. That person is trusted in Christ. Who are you to judge and condemn him if he's of the household of faith?
Right.
So the Bible says the Holy Spirit in us testifies the Holy Spirit's in you. Yeah. Now, you know, I've talked to people on the street, and I know very well the Holy Spirit's in them. He testifies to me that the Holy Spirit's in them, but their doctrine is all jacked up. If I just look at it by the letter of the law, they're not sick Christians. You know, I can crush that little seedling there. Any farmers out there, you know what seedlings are? They're just out of the seed case. You can crush that thing, a little bit of wind, too much water, you step on it, it's done. So when there's somebody has faith in Christ, that's their faith. You know, build up right doctrine in that person, be patient with them, and build that seedling into a sapling, into a great tree, amen? To a great tree for his honor.
Amen.
All right. So I would exhort all of you to read all, that's your homework. And I'm not going to have time to cover it all.
Yeah.
Your homework is go through there and figure out what's doubtful. Go all the way to verse 23, amen. And he that doubteth is damned if he eats, because he eats not of faith. And whatsoever is not of faith is sin.
Yeah.
If whatever you're doing is not by faith, it's sin. Amen. So when this man tells me over here, well, my wife preaches, she's preaching out of faith. Well, I don't let my wife preach because you know what? Women aren't supposed to speak on the streets. Okay. You're doing it by faith. You're doing it by faith. You both have arguments in the Bible. Hey, man, figure it out. You're both doing it by faith. Why dispute over it? No need to dispute over it. All right. So some things that we need to talk about for that Romans 14 passage is determine what's doubtful. Do not put doubtful stumbling blocks before each other. Avoid judging them as being condemned over such things as eating, Sabbaths, festivals, words, timings, understandings, styles, props, etc. Now, Sister Cindy Smock, she's got, I think it started with Reuben actually, the tampon tree thing. Oh, it's offensive to people, man. Especially ladies up there get really offended at the tampon tree. It's a menstrual rag. Their works are like menstrual rags, clear in the Bible, you know. Why couldn't I use that? You see what the prophets are doing back in the Old Testament?
Right.
Do you read that? Do you understand that?
Mm-hmm.
Okay, now the other part of this is, shouldn't we go, and I'll give you an example of this, remove stumbling blocks. I'll give you an example. Brother Jesse came to my place out in Kentucky. We preached about a week or so together. And we preached one day on Tennessee Tech University, told a story, as he's very good at telling stories, and I was offended by it. Now, I shouldn't have been offended by it, but I was at that time. I was offended. I said, brother, I think this is too coarse. I think it's too caustic, and I'd ask you not to do that. He said, okay, brother. Didn't do it anymore. He got my stumbling block out of the way, hallelujah, because he loved me more than he loved telling that story.
Amen.
Isn't that good?
Yeah.
Wow. So if I'm doing something in the open air, just like I went to James last night, I said, brother, forgive me. You know, if I've done something to offend you and your family by saying something coarse, I won't do that anymore. Mm. But here we're living in a modern era now, okay? So we have the internet, YouTube, Facebook, all this stuff. And so if you see me doing something you don't like, will you come talk to me first?
Amen.
Or you see something that Reuben's doing, carrying a pickette around and putting firecrackers in the air or whatever he's doing now with his different props, will you talk to him first? Before you go blasting something out on the internet, right. Oh, Reuben's a pig-headed pig carrier. You know, it's just dumb. Come on. Right. Matthew 18.
You go through all of them.
Okay, so how can we remove these doubtful things? How do we relate to each other in a way that doesn't compromise our faith yet cares for our brother in the same manner? Because I'm not saying things won't be wrong to you. To him that's pure, all things are pure. You know, if it's a sin to you, it's a sin to you. Maybe you can't walk with him. Say, brother, I love you, but I can't walk with you while you carry that sign. That particular sign, really, I just don't think that's good. I can't, but I love you, and I'll see you tomorrow. Or I'll preach down there. Amen?
Amen.
And last verse, James 4:17. Therefore, to him that knoweth to do good and doeth it not, him it is sin.
That's right.
Bless you guys.
Amen. Thank you, brother.